We were looking at how to modify our clock and data recovery circuit to handle the case where we don't have the forwarded clock from the transmitter. In order to do that, what we did was we took the case where we did have the forwarded clock, but we broke the feedback loop to see what happens if the clock is not aligned to the data. Okay. So, what did we see? This is the clock that we get from the feedback, and we have broken the feedback loop here. And we have our phase detector, whichever one we use. And now, if this clock was lagging data, what we saw was that we get a continuous stream of up pulses and this voltage keeps on ramping up. Okay? And if this keeps on ramping up, this delay goes on decreasing. So, this clock here, if I call it CKO, it has its rising edges move back in every cycle, right? It is as though basically it is at a higher frequency than clock in. Is this right? The first rising edge moves by some amount, the next one by twice that, and the next one by three times that, and so on. Okay. So, if you plot the phase of CKO versus time. Okay. When I say phase of CKO, it is actually the phase difference between CKO and CK in. What will that look like? What is that? Rising. Yeah, it will be a ramp. Okay. So, this means that actually CKO is at a higher frequency than CK in. Okay. Yeah, what I meant was that so do you agree that the control voltage versus time goes on increasing? That's okay. So then, what happens is the delay of this. We assume that the delay has a decreasing characteristic with VC. Okay. So what happens is that if this control voltage goes on increasing, this delay goes on decreasing. Tau is? It's not a VC. It's just a delay. This is still our old clock and data recovery circuit with the forwarded clock. Let's not worry about the wrap over. I mean, let's look at maybe it is going so slowly that we can look for many cycles before it can wrap over. Okay. So, if you look before the wrap over, it just looks like the edges are being pulled forward and it's at a higher frequency. Okay. So essentially, what it says is that so let's say we had a characteristic like this. What it says is that if this clock here is lagging D in, then we will get a stream of up pulses from the phase detector, and that should result in an increasing frequency of this one. Okay. Now, we will formulate it in terms of frequency, right? And similarly, if clock is leading D in, we will get a stream of down pulses, VC will ramp down with time, and we will get CKO with a reduced frequency. Is this okay? Now, if we assume that this delay is linear with Vc, what happens is that the phase of CKO will also be linear with time. Okay. So, what I mean to say is that if this clock is lagging d in by a fixed amount, then the frequency of CKO will be larger than the frequency of CK in by also by a fixed amount. Okay. Because the difference, the phase difference is a ramp, that means that frequency difference is a step. Okay. Is this fine? So, it is exactly the same thing that we have to do with a VCO. So, now we have to figure out what to put here, but basically if we have a VCO which produces CKO, its control voltage should be such that if CK is lagging D in by a fixed amount, this frequency should be higher than, higher by some fixed amount. Okay. So, what should be VC? Earlier you remember when CK was lagging D in by a fixed amount, VC was a ramp that gave a frequency changed by a fixed amount. Okay. Now, we do not have a delay line, we have a VCO. Okay. At the output of the VCO, we want the same behavior, that is a frequency change by a fixed amount. So, what should be VC? It should be a constant, right? It should be a step. Okay. Now, we still have the same charge pump structure here. We will get a, if CK is lagging D in, we will get a stream of up pulses. So, here I have to get a step instead of a ramp. So, what should I put? What should I have there? Resistor, right? If I have a capacitor, I will get a ramp voltage. If I have a resistor, on average, I will have a step. Is this okay? We will see how this whole thing works, but at least now you see that if CK is lagging D in, we will get a stream of up pulses. On average, you have a positive voltage here. That means that the VCO's frequency will be increased by some amount. Is this okay? Similarly, if CK is leading D in, we get a stream of down pulses. This will be a negative value and this frequency will be smaller by some amount. Frequency is smaller meaning the successive edges will move outward, right? Frequency is higher meaning successive edges will move inwards. Okay? So, we can change the phase of the VCO by changing the frequency. If we increase the frequency, we are pulling in the edges. If we reduce the frequency, we are pushing out the edges. Okay? So, what I was saying was that the equivalence is this. So, if we have a charge pump, everything is in the average sense. We have pulses of up and down, but think of only the average. Okay? Is roughly equivalent to okay. What is the meaning of equivalent here? If you ignore the phase wrapping that happens here, okay. If you get a stream of up pulses, this will keep ramping up and these edges will keep move inward. Similarly, here if you get a stream of up pulses, you get on average a positive voltage and you will have edges which are closer than if this voltage was 0. Okay? In that sense, these two are equivalent. Right? Now, what is the feature of this new circuit? We do not have an input clock, right? We are generating the clock right there. Of course, we have had some vague idea that we wanted to move the clocks inward, so we have increased the frequency and so on, but we can verify whether it works properly. Okay? Any questions about the reasoning so far? Free running frequency, exactly. So we'll come to that. Anything else? So let me complete the loop and also draw the VCO here like it is normally done. And complete this, this CK. Now, of course, first let me assume that magically the free running frequency of this VCO is exactly same as the frequency of the incoming clock. We know this can't happen, but just for initial argument, we'll assume that. Okay. Then what do you think will happen? Let's say initially the phase of this clock is leading the data, okay? The rising edges are to the left of data. What happens then? And the free running frequency is exactly the same as the frequency of the incoming clock. What do you think will happen? We get down pulses, so we'll get a negative voltage. Then what happens? VQC of frequency will reduce. So that means that the following edge will come a little later and little later and so on. Okay, so that will come closer to d in. As this is happening, the down pulses will become, if it is a linear phase detector, the area of the down pulses will become smaller and smaller. Okay, and eventually, where will it settle? Where will that settle? When VC is 0. So, what is the point of settling? That is correct, it is VC equal to 0, but where will this loop actually settle? I mean, in the earlier case it was clear, it was when the average current flowing into the capacitor was 0. So, here what should happen? The frequency should match, okay? Otherwise it will not be, right? Because if the frequencies are not matching, it means that in the first cycle, it will be in the phase of the clock will be in some position, in the next one it will be in a different position, right, if the frequencies do not match. The frequencies are matched, they will be in the same place in every clock cycle. Okay? So, here the frequencies will match, and let us assume a linear phase detector for simplicity, but it will work in exactly the same way with bang bang also. So, then what happens is that on average these two are injecting 0 current here. So, the average voltage here is 0. So, that means that output frequency is f naught, the free running frequency, which is the same as the incoming data frequency. Okay? So, now if f naught equals frequency of d in, then rising edge of C k will settle to the middle of the data period. Okay? Is this clear? Because it can't be otherwise, right? If the phase is different, we will get an average voltage which will change the frequency of the VCO. As the VCO frequency changes, the edges will move either outward or inward, and finally, that will change the up and down pulses until a point where the frequencies have to match, and also the up and down pulses will have an average of 0. Okay? This is fine. So, the next thing is to figure out what happens if the free running frequency is not equal to the frequency of the input data. What happens then? Where will it settle? And he says that it will settle to a point where the VCO's output frequency will match the frequency of the data. Is that correct? Does it sound reasonable? Yes, Gautam. Yeah, so first of all, it has to settle where the output frequency of the VCO will be the same as Dn. Again, if it is not the case, right, in every cycle, the position of the edge will be different. So, that means that up and down average will be changing and something will be changing, the frequency will be changing, right. So, it has to settle where the output frequency of the VCO equals the frequency of the data, okay. Then how will the edges align? How is the alignment of the clock edge with respect to data? How will be the, will it get aligned? That's correct, but we said that free running frequency is not equal to the incoming data frequency, but the set in when the settled state, the output frequency of the VCO has to be equal to incoming data frequency. So, what can you infer from that? What can you infer about the control voltage from that one? If the output frequency is different from the free running frequency, what do you, if the frequency of the VCO is different from the free running frequency, what do you infer about the control voltage? It will keep changing. No, no, but if in the settled state, the output frequency equals the data frequency, then the position of the clock will be the same in every data cycle, right? It will not be changing. So, what can you say about VC in this? Control voltage. It has to be non-zero, right? For the VCO to oscillate at a different frequency, it has to be non-zero, okay? So, if VC has to be non-zero, the control voltage has to be non-zero. What has to happen? Clearly, the rising edge of the clock cannot be aligned to the middle of the data, okay? It has to be either lagging or leading by a fixed amount, okay? This is the standard problem with any controller which has only proportional control, right? So, to get the VCO to oscillate at a different frequency, we need a non-zero control voltage. And to produce that non-zero control voltage, we need a non-zero phase difference between the edges of clock and the middle of the data, okay? So, this will lock to the right frequency, it will figure out the, I mean if you want to say it that way, figure out the frequency of the incoming data, but it is not in an optimum position to recover the data. Is this okay? F out of the VCO equals the frequency of Dn. This means that VC is not equal to 0, which means that there is a non-zero phase difference between CK and Dn. I think you know what it means. What I mean is that the rising edge of CK is not aligned to the middle of the data symbols, okay. So, the frequency is correct, but the phase is not correct. Yeah, the average value of ICP into R. We will assume that it will not respond to that fine steps. Yeah. No, no, no. Let's call this frequency f in, okay, and this f out, which is f naught plus k VCO times what is the average value of VC, okay, that is the output frequency of the VCO, right? This is equal to f in, okay. So the average value of VC is f in minus f naught by k VCO, And also the average value of Vc equals the phase difference for a linear phase detector divided by 2 pi times ICPR, right. So, in fact, this is a way to find out how much phase difference there is. If there is no difference between f in and f naught, that is, if the VCO happens to be VCO's free running frequency happens to be the same as the incoming data frequency, then this average value of Vc will be 0 and so will the phase difference. Okay. So, now if f in has to be greater than f naught, you have to have some phase difference, and similarly the other way. Okay. And the larger the difference between f in and f naught, the greater the phase difference between data and clock. Does it answer your question? It does not matter, because when there is no transition, there are no pulses going into Vc, right. Oh, you mean, okay, for this equation, yes, here I have to have a density factor, that is right, because the average value of Vc is related to the density of data. Okay. Average output of the phase detector is related to transition density. Thanks. Okay. So, we now have a new circuit, but which works only in the magical case where the free running frequency of the VCO equals the incoming data frequency. Okay. So, clearly this is not a practical one. So, how do we make this work? Can we change the free running frequency of a VCO? Yeah. So, actually the free running frequency is somewhat arbitrary, right. So, in fact, it is arbitrary in that if this VCO has some free running frequency, let us say I have some V offset and this has a free running frequency of f naught, and I call this my VCO. Okay. We call this whole thing my VCO. So, this whole thing will have a free running frequency of f naught plus k VCO times V offset. Okay. So, if you add an offset, a DC offset, a slowly varying offset to the control voltage of a VCO. So, that is like changing the free running frequency of the VCO. Okay. So, what we have to do in addition to what we have done, right, is also to add an offset, so that eventually that offset should be such that what? Yeah, basically when so this whole thing should become equal to the input frequency, right. After that this Vc will be provided by the resistor. Okay. Is this fine? To do this we have to measure the difference between f naught and f in, right. Based on the difference between the free running frequency and the incoming data frequency, we can update this offset. Okay. Do we have in our system a measure of this? How do we know what the difference between f naught and f in is? How do we find out the difference between the free running frequency and the input frequency? Huh? Yeah. What I meant to say was that we already have a measure, right? That is the phase difference between this and that, okay? Because the phase difference between this and that would be 0 if there is no frequency difference. It will be non-zero if there is a frequency difference. So, in fact, the phase detector output is also a measure of the difference between the free running frequency of the VCO and the data frequency, okay? So, all we have to do is you can work out that it will be in the right polarity. So, there is the output of the phase detector, which is the average value of up minus down. Okay. Earlier, that average value, I mean something proportional to that, we were passing it through a resistor and giving it to the VCO. Now, we also have to integrate it. Okay. So, that is all that is there to it. I can show the picture with proportional and integral paths and so on, and instead of that I will show the practical realization itself. This has a free running frequency of f naught, and this is Vc and this is Ck. Okay. This is fine. Now, let us first assume that the C is very large, okay, very very large, okay, and initially its voltage is 0. Okay. So, then what we can think of, we can think of this whole thing as, this voltage is 0, right. This whole thing is like the system we studied earlier, this R was connected to ground, right, it was more or less like that. So, what happens is, so let us say the input frequency is greater than f naught. Okay. So, then what should happen to Vc here? It has to be positive. Okay. So, this will initially, I mean I will say settle, it is not completely settled, it will initially settle with average value of Vc greater than 0. What does it mean to have average value of Vc greater than 0? There is a net average current flowing out of the charge pump, right? The average up is more than average down. Okay. But in this case it is slightly different. What is different? So, earlier it was just going to stay there, right? Average value of Vc was going to be more than 0, and this clock was going to lag the data, right, by some amount. Okay. So, now what is different? What will happen? Yeah, this non-zero current will also charge the capacitor. It will do it slowly, but it will go on increasing this voltage. Okay. As this voltage increases, that is like adding an offset to the control voltage of the VCO, right. You can think of it in any way, it is either providing a voltage at the input of the VCO, or it is adding an offset to the control voltage, so that it is changing its free running frequency, it does not matter, any which way you think about it, it is the same. So, as this voltage increases, right, so you do not need as much voltage across the resistor, right. Earlier, the positive voltage Vc that is required to match the output frequency of this to the incoming frequency was provided entirely by the resistor. Here what happens is, maybe initially it is by the resistor, so the clock is in the wrong place although at the right frequency, but slowly the capacitor will charge up, the amount of voltage needed across R is smaller, so this average will go on reducing, and where will it settle? When the average is 0, obviously, otherwise this capacitor voltage will never stop moving, right. So, this whole thing will stop when the capacitor voltage stops changing, that means that the average current output from the charge pump is 0, okay. And at that point, the frequency of the VCO will be the same as the incoming frequency, and the phase of the clock will be aligned correctly, that means that the rising edge of the clock will be in the middle of the data symbols. Is this okay? So, finally, what will happen? This capacitor here will hold a voltage, I will call this, maybe I should not have called this Vc, I will call this VcTL and this as Vc. This will be the voltage that is required to change the frequency of the VCO to the incoming frequency, okay. And the voltage across the resistor will have an average of 0, but it will respond to fast changing phase transitions of Dn, okay. That is how it will be finally. So, this will provide the average voltage, so that the frequency moves to the right place, and then any small phase changes that is required because of jitter or other things will be provided by R. Okay. So, later we will evaluate these things quantitatively, but what we have done so far is correct, we will come to the same conclusion that the voltage across C must change slowly. So, that part has to be slow, otherwise this whole loop does not work properly. Okay. So, you should think of it as some sort of quasi-static thing where the voltage across C is some constant, then the change in voltage across R will provide the phase correction, then Vc will change by a little more and so on. Okay. So, the integral path is slower than the proportional path, if you want to put it in the terminology of control systems. Is this okay? So, now we have also a system which works for the case without a forwarded clock, and it is also not very difficult to realize, as you can see. Only thing is, we need an oscillator. We have alternatives to the oscillator, but we have to somehow generate this variable frequency, right, because we do not know what the frequency is. And this whole system finally settles to a point where the frequency is right and the phase is right. Is it okay? What is the problem with if R is 0? Yeah, actually the loop will be unstable. Okay, that we can if we put down the small signal model of this, it comes out very easily. Okay. I don't know if there is an intuitive way to explain that. No, no, that is not relevant. Actually, you need to have a resistance in series with the capacitor. Okay. Yeah, intuitively it is harder to tell, except that you have current going into a capacitor, the voltage changes with a phase lag, right. So, that phase lag basically makes the loop unstable, okay, because let us say this gives you an up pulse, which means that the phase should be advanced, but it won't be advanced immediately, okay. So, it will happen with a delay. So, the phase will swing like back and forth, and that is what instability is, okay. But if we do the quantitative analysis, it is very obvious that it is. Any questions about this? Yeah, that is correct. That is exactly what I was saying. I mean, if we do not have a resistor, we have two integrators in the loop without any other bypass path. So, that is why it is unstable. Okay. Any questions? No, no, the frequency of the VCO will be related to the total voltage here. Okay. Yeah, VC, okay. Yeah, that is right. Why? No, no, in fact, finally, when the loop settles, F naught plus KVCO times VC should be equal to the data frequency. Okay, and the average value of the voltage across R should be 0. No, data frequency is not necessarily F naught. Okay. In fact, that is only initially what I assume. Right now, it is not F naught. F naught is the free running frequency of the VCO. Okay. VC will settle to finally, so this is VCTL, F naught plus KVCO times the capacitor voltage will be equal to Fn. And the average value of the resistor voltage will be 0, okay, because the average value of the charge pump current will be 0. Okay. So, this will ask the, if you now let us say change the frequency of the incoming data, this will adapt itself also. Okay. Any questions? So, we have got the two basic topologies for clock and data recovery with and without forwarded clock. With forwarded clock, we only need a variable delay, and that we control based on the phase difference between the input clock and data. And similarly, without forwarded clock, we have to have a VCO whose frequency and phase will be changed based on the phase difference between incoming data and the clock. Okay. The way to change the, so let's say if the VCO is at the right frequency, but its phase is wrong, the way to change the phase is, you momentarily change the frequency, then the phase will get changed and you change the frequency back. Now, it will settle to a different phase, okay. So, that is how even phase alignment is possible with a VCO, okay. Now, as far as the phase detection itself is concerned, we also have two possible topologies. One is a linear phase detector and the other is a bang bang phase detector. And all four combinations are possible. That is, we can use either linear or bang bang phase detector, either with forwarded clock or without forwarded clock. But I already mentioned some disadvantages with the linear phase detector for very high frequency usage. So, most frequently we use bang bang phase detector, but analysis wise linear phase detector is easier. As usual, linear systems are a lot easier to analyze. And bang bang phase detector has some disadvantages also, that its characteristics can it depend on the jitter of the incoming data and so on, okay. So, we will evaluate all that quantitatively. So, far we have intuitively said that hey, this looks like it will align the clock and things like that. We also need to find out, like, let us say how fast it will align, or let us say the phase of the incoming data changes by a little bit, how does this respond? It has to, right. And similarly, if the incoming data is jittery, whether the clock jitter will follow it or how much will it follow it and so on, okay. All these things we will have to evaluate. Is this fine? Now, one thing with all clock and data recovery circuits is everything depends on the transition density. So, we can first imagine that we will do everything with alternating data, which has transition density of 1, and then you can include a density factor in the whole calculation. Of course, whatever loop design you have to do, it has to be done so that it works for any density factor that you expect, okay. And in general, all clock and data recovery circuits have problems with very small data densities, very small transition densities, okay. That is reasonable, because if you do not have any transition, you do not have any information of what the incoming clock is, right. I mentioned earlier, if you get a high symbol for 1 nanosecond, we do not know whether it is 10 ones at 10 gigabits per second or 20 ones at 20 gigabits per second, who knows, right. You need to have transitions, that is the only way you can find out what the incoming frequency is, okay. Any questions? I mean, that is, all this is all this applies to, everything I said applies to the case without forwarded clock. If you have forwarded clock, of course, you know that the frequency is supposed to be the frequency of the forwarded clock, okay. No, no, I mean, sometimes you can do that. Let us say we have a very difficult channel where you need to have some initial training for the clock recovery. The clock recovery has difficulty locking. Usually, if you send alternating bit pattern, it will lock, and then after that you can switch over to normal data. But that is not necessary. Usually, you can send the regular data with random data and it should be fine. Random data meaning if you have transition density of half, it is still okay, right. So, also this training can be used for various purposes, for training the clock recovery or more importantly for equalization. But many standards will have, will either not have a training period or will have some specific training period for some purposes and so on. Clock and data recovery circuits can work with random data of transition density of half without training, usually. Okay. In this case, we are not, right. So, no, no, that is what, why do we do that at all? Yeah, this system is more complicated than recovering, than having the clock and recovering it. That is one thing. When you have, so basically when you have a bus of data, let us say 16 bits or 64 bits, having like one more clock channel does not seem too expensive. Now, one more thing is that this one, if you let us say have a very widely varying data frequency. Okay, sometimes I think this can happen in computers and so on, where depending on the load, you may operate the data bus at very widely varying rates. So, something like this with a VCO will have a very hard time adapting. You need to know at least where to start, okay. If you do not know the data, let us say it could be anywhere between 1 and 10 gigahertz, this will take a long time to lock. Whereas, if you do send the clock, you already immediately know what frequency it is. So, especially when you have a large bus, then that the thing with the clock seems like more economical, in that although it is overhead of sending one more extra channel, maybe if you include all the power overhead of including all this for every channel, you may save power because the receiver is a lot simpler. Okay, the receiver is simpler mainly with the forwarded clock. That's the point. Okay. With the burst of data. Yeah, you do need that. Now, the way implementation may be different. If you have a bus of data signals with, let us say that you know that the frequency is exactly the same, then maybe you can use this for one and use a phase shifter for the remaining, right? Because if the frequency is exactly the same, you can do that. Okay? And also in a lot of modern implementations, we do not actually have a VCO like this. We do have a VCO, but the way to generate this multiple phases is still, we have a VCO and we have something known as a phase interpolator, and that is what is controlled by the up and down signals. Okay? So, if you have a bus, the VCO will be common to all the signals, all the channels, and the phase interpolator will be separate for each one. But usually this, when you have this case of no clock with data, we are not talking about a very large bus. I think that is not the case. We usually have a small number of channels, okay, or maybe one. Any other questions? No, I mean, again, like I said, this, if you want to just start this and expect it to work, it will work with F naught being different from F in, but not a wide difference. It cannot be that F naught is 10 gigahertz and F in is 1 gigahertz. This will not lock. Okay? So, they have to be within some range, right? Otherwise, this the phase detector output will not be able to pull it to the right frequency. So, we are now talking about, I mean, most frequently occurring case is when you have nominally the same crystal frequency on the transmitter and receiver. So, we are talking about maybe 0.1% type of difference between the clock frequencies, but that is still a big enough difference, right? You cannot recover data without actually recovering the clock. So, in those cases you can start this and expect it to work. Okay? Otherwise, with large differences, what you need is an auxiliary frequency detector, which will first figure out the frequency and set the frequency of this VCO to roughly the right value, and then you can start this clock recovery based on phase detection. There are many things, right? To bring the frequency close, we can use many arrangements like a frequency detector and so on. So, right now all we have is, we are using simply the phase difference between D in and clock to move, push and pull the frequency and phase. Okay? But this will work only in a limited frequency difference range. With very large frequency differences, what happens is you can have multiple edges of clock within data or the other way around, and then the phase detector will completely misbehave. You should start with the case which is nearly having one edge of clock in every cycle of the data, otherwise this will not work nicely. Okay. Anything else? So, now we need to make a model of this so that we can say some things quantitatively, right? So, when you say a model in the phase, right? So, what do I mean by that? So, let us say I take a periodic signal first. Okay. So, then I take another signal which is like this. And then all the edges are moved to the left. Okay, so this is one case, and we could have another case where I'm trying to explain in time domain, because we can just make the frequency domain model and phase domain model and express everything in terms of the frequency of the phase, but it may or may not make much sense. Okay, we could have another one where in one cycle it is pulled inward and after that everything is the same. Okay, now what does it mean in terms of the phase? Here the phase difference between black and red, what is that? It is a step function, right? This is a phase step. What about this? This is like a phase impulse. Okay, so it is the response to this type of stuff that we will be studying. When we make transfer functions in the phase domain, what does the transfer function in the phase domain correspond to? The inverse Laplace transform will be the impulse response to phase. But what does it mean? Roughly speaking, it is to a response to this red signal, okay, where one cycle is shifted to the left. So then how it settles, okay, that is the impulse response corresponding to the phase. Similarly, if all cycles are shifted, of course, in reality neither of it is true, but we have a linear model. So what it means is that maybe the data will have jitter. Okay, so ideally it is supposed to be like this. And then in reality it may be like this and then like that, and who knows, maybe like this. So it will have some sort of jitter. Okay, so how does it respond to that? Because it is linear, we just apply this and then find out from the transfer function what the response is. Okay, so initially it may be a little hard to imagine these phase domain transfer functions, but this is what we mean. Okay, we have this I would not say periodic signals, but these signals with a certain phase, okay, and the phase itself is time varying. If you want to imagine that, you should imagine these rectangular type pulses whose phases are varying in that way. Okay, so when we evaluate the impulse response to a phase, really what we are doing is we will be stepping back one pulse and then looking at how things will behave. Okay, so this is what it is, this is what we will be doing. So, by making phase domain models, we can study this, and it is very useful because in this case, we are not interested in the exact voltages. We know that everything is supposed to be either ones and zeros. What we are interested in are the timing. Okay, so that we can get quite easily from this. And then in both clock and derivative recovery as well as phase lock loops, it is very common to use phase domain models and transfer functions, because that is what we are interested in. Okay, and there are lots of criteria in terms of the phase, that is, if the data input data is input data phase is changing by a lot, how does the output change? The clock should follow it so that it will recover, but maybe it should not follow it too much, because if you use that clock elsewhere, that will be a problem, etcetera, etcetera. Okay, so we will look at the phase domain model tomorrow. Any questions?